C'è Maicon che chiama palla, dategli la palla a Maicon, quello c'è in gran destra, attenzione, la palla per Danielino, go! 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 Danielino! 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 Danielino, un anno e tre mesi che aspetto, un anno e tre mesi che sto aspettando sto gol, è da maggio del 2012 che sto aspettando
Hello,
sto gol,
Hello and
Danielino.
Welcome to the first of a new part of Roma Press. This is an InfoPod where instead of discussing the day-to-day running of Roma as we do in our other podcast series, we're going to be giving information on certain parts of history, parts of Calcio and other such things. Today we're going to be talking about Calciopoli, which is of course the match-fixing scandal that happened in the last decade involving Juventus, meaning they got relegated to Serie B. But first, if you have any sort of inquiries, please email info@romapress.com. I'm joined by our two regulars, our Roman, Giovanni. Gio, how are you?
Hi, James. Nice to be here.
And I'm also joined by Daniele from South Africa, of course, another one of our regulars. Danny, how are you?
Cheers, James. Great to be here.
So today we're going to be talking about, of course, the match-fixing scandal, which involved Juventus over the past 10 years. It's a completely factual opinion, and hopefully we can bring people who don't necessarily know too much about it up to speed about it. And one of those people, funnily enough, is me. The only experience I had with the match-fixing scandal before I actually got into Calcio was when I was playing Football Manager back in the day, and Juventus the previous season had won Serie B, and I found it very strange that a club as impressive as Juventus had fallen so low into Serie B. They'd been relegated. I couldn't believe it. But of course, a couple of years later, I came back and I realised that, of course, it was because of the match-fixing scandal. So let's talk about this. This overall, I mean, Gio, of course, you lived through it. You lived through the events. Oh, I suppose we all did, but you were probably the one following it the most. So, could you give us sort of a brief outline of what it is?
Yeah. Let's say that the investigation itself. I mean, dates back to a really long, long time ago. I mean, we could really go back to 2003. Actually, because that's probably the year the investigative team that was assigned to overlook what was happening in Calcio was put into action. Actually, the first media attention that Calciopoli had was in 2003, and it was on the Il Romanista, which was an Italian newspaper based in Rome, and that was only focused on AS Roma, on the team. The director at the time was Riccardo Luna, which is a very famous journalist here in Italy, and since October 2003, they started publishing about the possible, let's say, havoc coming through the Italian football. When we really have the explosion of this problem is during 2006, because right before the tournament ended, I mean 2005-2006 Serie A, there was an interview by Moggi, who was the Juventus director of football at the time. Where he basically said, he went in front of the cameras and he said, "I'm leaving Juventus. They stole my soul." Yeah, I know it's ironic hearing Moggi talking about stealing something. And he basically said, "I'm resigning and I'm getting away." After that, the main Italian newspapers, mainly L'Espresso, is one of the most prominent one in that period, started to become more aware of what was going around. So they sent journalists, they asked into about the authorities of what was going around, and finally during the heart of the tournament, let's say, this kind of bubble exploded and everything came to the surface. We know basically what went on the press, basically about match fixing, about bribing referees, about having control in the Italian Federation, And at that moment, let's say when just when the tournament ended, it was mainly about one team, and it was Juventus. I mean, it was really Juventus who was in the, which was in the high of the hurricane, as you would say. But later on, we discovered that it was, let's say, way more complicated. We had Milan, we had Lazio, we had Regina, we had Messina, we had Fiorentina to a certain extent. Later on, we discovered about Inter as well. I mean, in recent years, but it couldn't be prosecuted because of the status bar of the law. And after that, I mean, that's the way Calciopoli just came to the first surface, what was all about. From then on, it was about the investigation, the trials, both on a sports level and on a criminal level. And this went on for several years, and it's still going on for what concerned the, as I asked for the criminal trial, because it's still taking place right now.
So you mentioned not only Juventus being involved, of course they seem to be the key, but you mentioned Milan and Lazio and Fiorentina, like you said, to an extent. Inter as well, of course. Inter couldn't be, weren't persecuted for it because it was found out later Inter were involved. But let's exclude Inter. Let's talk about the other teams who are involved. I don't understand. Were they persecuted as well? Was it just fines for them? Were they relegated? What happened?
You mean about Milan, Lazio?
Yeah,
and
Milan, Lazio. Yeah, yeah.
Well, let's say Milan, Lazio, Regina, and Fiorentina as well just got a, let's say, a penalty. I mean, they were just some points they made on the field were just get rid of it by the authorities, both in the 2005 and 2006 championship, both in the upcoming tournament, which was 2006, 2007. Yeah, they got fined as well. We got specific sentences for managers. We can name a few. Most of them are still around. We have, you know, Galliani, which was banned from the federation for 3 years. Della Valle, who is the current Fiorentina owner. Lotito as well got a multi-year ban, and several other persons in the scandal. Of course, we can talk about Moggi and Giraudo, who were the, let's say, the two main members of the triumvirate that was, let's say, at the head of this criminal commission. Of course, Moggi got a life ban, and is currently facing an incrimination for a criminal association aimed towards, let's say, not really fixing matches, but let's try to say, put these matches in a certain direction. I mean, by getting involved with the referee and such, he got sentenced guilty in the first stage and in the appeal courts, and now it's going to the Supreme Court. It will probably take between 1 and 2 years to know the final result of this on a criminal level. Of course, on a sports level, we had the sentences in that specific years. But yeah, it was not about just Juventus. Let's say Juventus was just the team that got relegated. But even other teams like Milan, Fiorentina, Lazio got their punishment as well.
So just to be clear, the reason Juventus got relegated and none of the other teams did, they obviously just had fines. Was that because Juventus were just the biggest part of it? Or was it just that they were a big club and it was an example? What was that?
Let's say that Juventus were probably, let's say, the big fish in all the scandal. Because you see, you have basically some kind of dichotomy, because you had Juventus and Milan trying to fight for power, and you had basically Milan which was trying to get some advantages on the referee side. And Juventus' aim was literally to control the whole process and the whole idea of controlling Calcio at federation level. And then you had other clubs like Fiorentina and Lazio, which have to be seen from a different perspective. For example, Lazio was a kind of team that tried to take advantage of the system that was created after Moggi came to power in Juventus. And let's say it was a club that was just trying to get the crumbs of what was happening, try to get a favor now and then. And then you have Fiorentina. Well, Fiorentina position is really different from others because Fiorentina was basically, at a certain point in time, they were really anti-establishment. And with anti-establishment, I mean against Moggi, Juventus, Galliani, Milan, and other entities I will refer to later. But the problem with Fiorentina is that basically, at a certain point in the league, they were facing relegation. So what De La Valle did is he went to Moggi, Bergamo, Pairetto, and many other people that were associated with Juventus and tried to, I will say, beg them to have an end and to stay in Serie A, basically switch side because it was on his own interest. And I know that this is not just speculation. There are even recordings joined by the police here in Italy about De La Valle joining Moggi's son Alessandro and the head of the referee department, like Moggi and Pareto. They literally had meetings in Tuscany trying to find a deal, and that's why Fiorentina was later punished during the trial. The final punishment for Fiorentina was getting 15 points penalization, and that it was actually the biggest penalization if we don't consider Juventus, because for example Milan got 8, Lazio got 3. Well, Juventus got 9, but they were relegated to Serie B, so there's some kind of difference.
We'll move on to asking Daniele a question, almost an editorial question. Because it happened so recently, and then obviously the last three or four seasons have been pretty bad for Calcio in terms of Europe, in terms of money in comparison to other leagues as well. They're a former shadow of what they once were before this. Obviously there are other contributing factors, the lack of foreign investment, perhaps the obviously you have some Italian sort of families not particularly wanted to sell the club. Obviously that's changing now with Roma, and I think Bologna have just been bought by an American company. But
actually it was Joe Tacopina who was the guy that brought our American ownership, the one we have right now in Rome.
Well, feeder club technically.
Hopefully. Yeah.
Well. Anyway, as I was saying, so there's a host of contributing factors as to why Serie A hasn't got as many broadcasting rights, isn't as powerful as perhaps the Premier League is, the La Liga and Bundesliga as well. Danny, do you think that the match fixing scandal was the key reason? One of the key reasons why Serie A sort of fell into decline, because of that.
I suppose it would be hard to argue against that. I think the decline would have come anyways, just based on other things such as stadia infrastructure, general debt of the clubs, etc. But I suppose if there's a betting scandal in your league, it also scares away big sponsorship, sponsors coming into the league, and generally just gives a bad impression to everyone who looks at the league. And well, like I said, I think the decline would have still come, but I think even now you see on Twitter and other social media a lot of fans of the Premier League, etc., use that match fixing against Italy to show why it isn't one of the top leagues. Although betting and match fixing happens in other leagues, we've seen it in lower division English football recently. I think it was earlier this year. But I think probably the match fixing scandal in 2006 probably used as a catalyst to speed up the decline of Italian football. But I think we still would have seen the decline regardless.
I have to say I agree with Danny, because while the problems of culture are structural, I mean, it's not just about a team getting relegated or another team getting punished by removing some points from the table. It's something broader and wider than that. Just think at Milan, they were proven guilty during the Calciopoli scandal, yet the year later they went on to win the Champions League. It's not that easy. Something that has really damaged probably Calcio as a whole was the blow that was given to Juventus, because let's face it, they may had to, let's say, cheat or have a very unethical approach. But yet, if you look at Juventus 2016, it was jaw-dropping team, was a massive team. Just look at name. They had Nedved, they had Trezeguet, they had Cannavaro, Thuram, Zambrotta, Camoranesi. It was something really, a powerhouse. I would say an European powerhouse. That's why a few years earlier than that, they reached the Champions League final, actually. So if you have a team that is that strong, and you just relegate this team to the Serie B and force this team to restructure all its management, all of its operations, of course it's going to be a very big blow. We still had some kind of success. We can think about the Milan winning the Champions League, Inter winning the Champions League. But yeah, as Danny said, the decline was bound to happen, because we know that after in the Champions League we went by Inter, everything went down, and there was no way Italian football could recover the competitive advantage that England or Spain or Germany had and currently have.
So let's talk about how this sort of story developed. You said it started in 2003 originally, but how did it all sort of develop from that?
Yeah, let's say that we went through a trial. It was carried out by the sport justice, let's say that basically at the end of October and at the start of December 2006, we already had the final sentences for the club. You can already understand that this is not a very good aspect of it, because if you take literally 4 months just to sort all these turmoil out, it's probably means you didn't do your best to fix the problem. For what concern the development, let's say the sport justice aspect of it was done, and then we had the criminal trials that are taking place in Napoli at the moment. We went through the first stage, then appeal, and now we're going towards the Supreme Court that will give us a definite judgment. I have to say that right now at criminal level, it's not about the club anymore, it's about management. I mean, we have people like De Santis, we have people like Mochi, of course, being persecuted by the justice, and it's not only about the Calciopoli itself, we have different things that's were unveiled by the that's incredible. And then we had the Gia World Trial, which was again always all about Moggi, his son Alessandro Moggi, and they were basically an agent agency in Italy, and they had, let's say, almost, I wouldn't say a monopoly because it wasn't like that, but they had some kind of power over the possibility to negotiate contract, to decide which players could go to specific teams, and they were actually let's say accused or forming a criminal organization which affected the competition. They went to the Supreme Court at the end of the at the end of all the journey, but they didn't get any say they couldn't reach a sentence because the trial was status bar, because at a certain point in time they reached the point where they could not be prosecuted anymore. That's the point. So we really don't have a we don't know if there's a guilty or a not guilty Moggi or Gia in this process, but it was not really just about let's say football itself, football on the pitch, but it was also about all what went around the culture system and the main actors of it.
Let's move on to that. So who were the main actors? You mentioned Moggi a lot, who of course is a lifetime ban, but appeal going to the Supreme Court in Italy and all that. And then also, aside from like who were the main actors in that, who had the biggest responsibilities out of all of them?
You mean about the ones who get sentenced and persecuted in the...
Well, yeah, let's include both, the ones who managed to get away and the ones who were persecuted, yeah.
Yeah, let's say some people say that Moggi was probably, say, the leader of all this kind of system he created. Actually, in Italian, it's called Sistema Moggi, which means the Moggi system, and it's about one person just controlling every aspect of culture. What most people tend to overlook, though, is where the real power in calcio, in Italian football, lies. Because you see, of course, Moggi was involved on a personal level. I mean, it was the director of football for Juventus. Galliani also had a general director in Milan. But honestly, you could argue that Galliani was way more powerful than Moggi in that context, and still today, because you know Galliani is a Berlusconi man, and what is keeping the culture strong are TV rights. Of course, we know everything about how AC Milan is owned by Fininvest, how Mediaset is in Fininvest, about Berlusconi's TVs. And Galliani has been the president in Lega Calcio as well. And of course, he really had a strong position. Actually, there are call transcript of Moggi saying, yeah, we desperately need Galliani to stay there in the Lega Calcio and to have a strong position. Because it's not about Moggi versus Galliani. It's all about, Calciopoli was all about making the most out of culture financially. There are people that maybe football fan, Italian football fan at South Italy never heard about, like Franco Carraro, Cesare Geronzi. Those are, you could argue Beretta as well at the moment, but I wouldn't put him into the, let's say, Calciopoli sphere of influence. But these guys were the people who had the real power, because you see, in football, everyone is losing money, apart from footballers and people who are employed. I'm talking about owners and management, because at the end of the day, football clubs have always huge losses. You can pick some examples that say the opposite here and there. I don't know, I can think about Manchester United. But in Italy, it's all about getting the money in and getting no return. Banks generally play a major role in Italian football. It's actually the biggest role they play because they're literally the only entities that make money out of it. I was referring to UniCredit first, and there is a Capitalia, which was a bank that is now owned by, it has been incorporated inside UniCredit. That was really, let's say, the grey eminence of calcio in Italy, because they had relationships with virtually any club. I'm talking providing credit lines, helping them to cover their debt, and so on and so on. This kind of financial assistance to the clubs gave Capitale a huge amount of power. We, as Roma fans, we should know this very well as well, because Capitalia during the Sensi era, especially Ursula Sensi, the daughter of Franco, was really in a very complicated situation financially, because she owed so much money to Capitale that it was basically limited to do whatever they wanted to do. So you had Franco Carraro, which is called il poltronissimo in Italy, that roughly translates as someone who just wants to have his head stuck in a chair. He always wants a political position because he has always been into the in politics, not just in football. You had Carraro acting as at a federal level, in the football federation, and then you had Geronzi who took care of the financial side of it. So it's not really about Moggi, Galliani, etc. You could argue that Moggi and Galliani were more like the, the result of this kind of, entrepreneurship by bankers that wanted to have the most return out of calcio. And for the bankers and for these kind of investors, the best solution for Serie A was to have the three big teams, that means Juventus, Milan, and Inter, to be at the top position in the league to make the best results, for a simple reason, because if you do the best results and you're on top, if you're influent, you get the most out of the Tiberias deal. And that's about it, because through financing, if Geronzi, Capitale and company, and Intesa, San Paolo, Monte dei Paschi financed Milan, Juventus and Inter, was to get a return. And the only way they could be sure there would have been a return is by having this club strong, as business. Because you don't know, but for example, Juventus is listed on the stock exchange, same with Roma, same with Lazio, Milan and Inter are not, but the point still stands. As you said you earlier, I will divide the actors in two layers. You have, the bottom layers, which is the foundation, where you have the banks, Geronzi and Carraro, trying to keep the status quo, because it has always been about this. And at the lower level, you had the three big clubs, and at the higher level, you had the three big clubs, and at an even higher level, you have this kind of, Machiavellian management. People like Moggi, Mazzini, Galliani, Lotito, trying to make the most out of culture. That's, I think, how it should be. We should picture Calciopoli and Italian football. From a power perspective, it's kind of like a pyramid with the biggest powers being at the bottom, and going just straight to the top, where you make the layer of the pyramid with just the football team and the management, and ultimately the referee, and last but not least, the media, because the media had a real impact before Calciopoli and after.
It was interesting listening to that about your point of the banks as well. I had no idea it went as deep as it did. I thought it was just a standard sort of match fixing thing, but it seemed, I can understand now how it's sort of, you know, it's really, really made deep cracks into sort of the system of Calcio as well. So, I mean, overall, how did it all end? Who was brought to justice? What happened with the sports justice, the criminal justice? I'm not exactly sure how it works. How did it all go? How did the prosecution go?
As we said earlier, basically we had the final sentences during the late 2006. We had Juventus being relegated and being stripped of the Serie A title of 2004-2005 and the Serie A title 2005 and 2006. They got relegated. They got 9 points penalty for the 2006-2007 Serie B. Then you got Fiorentina. They actually got 30 points of penalty. That was, yeah, it was basically the highest. I'm talking about the previous season, of course. It's about 2005-2006, and 15 points in the upcoming season. You got Milan, we got 8 points in the upcoming season, and Lazio 3. Regina got 11, and Arezzo got C, because even Serie B was, from a certain perspective, involved. Then you can talk about the management. I mean, the big wheels in Calcio. You got Lotito got a 4 months, Galliani got 5 months, Moggi of course got a life ban, then you got De La Valle who got 8 months, got 1 year and 1 month, Giraudo got a life ban, and others. You got a referees as well, like Massimo De Santis, who was really a strong figure in that kind of system. And of course you had the heads of the refereeing association. I'm talking about Pairetto and Bergamo. Of course, I know it may sound strange, but it was usual to have all the... it was really, let's say, it was something that was incented by the federation to have, let's say, managers from and presidents from the team to get in touch with these people. It was legal, but it was decided to do so on purpose, just so people like Galliani, Moggi, etc., could have a really direct contact with these people and may influence them in their decision. And then, of course, we have the criminal trial. I've talked about the JR World, about the football agency, and let's say in the Napoli criminal trial, we have gone with Pairetto, Mazzini, De Santis, and Moggi, and others that went through all the stages of Calciopoli. And now we're heading towards the Supreme Court sentence. It's probably going to take about, I don't know, maybe 1 year, maybe two, depends on the what difficulties will the judges face. But I will say that at the moment, it's pretty much sure that Moggi is going to get a definite final sentence for criminal associations.
That's very interesting. Let's talk about how it was the media received the commission and how it was handled by the media, how the whole thing was handled by the media.
Well, I will say that it was probably shameful because, let's say, something that most people overlook about Calciopoli is the media influence that team like Juventus or Milan and its owner had. I mean, you can just see that right now. Just look at the shareholders of Gazzetta dello Sport. Not really Gazzetta dello Sport. It's the group of which Gazzetta is part. I mean, first main owner is Fiat, second main owner is Berlusconi Media Group, then you got De La Valle, etc., etc. But it's just now, I mean, back in the days, it was even worse because there are a lot of video recording, call recording that really makes you sick. I mean, it's really disgusting the way Moggi and others try to influence the public opinion through the media, because it's it was only about giving a positive view of Juventus. I'm making just two examples for it. I mean, there is a recording of the Italian police of Moggi going to an Italian restaurant in Rome and bringing all the very prominent journalists, not just in sports, but even in other sectors, just to have just to talk with them. He brought them gifs, I don't know, like watches, ties, jewelry, and all this kind of things, just trying to have them on his side, to on his sphere of influence, in a way that Juventus could be effectively being represented by those people on newspapers, on TV, etc., etc. Another very, I would say, striking example of this is what Moggi did with the television football programs. There is a specific one that was called the Processo di Biscardi. It was very famous. It's not like that anymore. But basically, what they did in this program is they had some kind of replay of the controversial episodes that happened during Serie A, Coppa Italia, and all the Italian football. What they did is they used some kind of 3D software to represent what happened in the pitch and give an opinion. I mean, the shocking thing about it and the the shameful thing about it is that Moggi and the host, that was Biscardi, basically were in touch and they were talking about adjusting the replay of these episodes in a way that they were made to look Juventus on the right side. So, for example, if you had an offside position and you're replicating this this through a 3D software just to see where the referee is wrong, what the program did was just change the position of a player a little bit that was offside and put him offside and have the guy on television just say, yeah, but that is not it's not offside, it's completely onside, it's not a good call. I mean, it's not just about bribing. Not just about having influence on the referee, having influence in the federation. Also, the small things count towards the greater objective, which is the control of Italian football. If you have control on the media, and there were an awful lot of journalists that were on Moggi's side, and some of them got suspended from the order of journalists here in Italy. I mean, that's really something that makes you doubtful about all the media, what is the direction of the media for what concerns Juventus and Milan. Even today, I mean, I don't have to speak about Milan. I mean, they got basically 50% of the market share of mainstream television in Italy. I mean, should I expect, an unbiased view of what Milan is doing by Mediaset or I don't know, by Corriere della Sera or other newspapers which are owned by or directed or one way or another controlled by Berlusconi? I don't think so.
Okay, let's move on now to the second more recent scandal. I can't really believe there's been two of these over the past decade. Correct me if my Italian pronunciation is slightly off here, but is it Calcio Scommessi? Is that
perfect?
Right? Oh, perfect, excellent. Right, okay, so let's talk about this one. Not as well publicised, of course, but could you give me just a brief lowdown on what happened, what was involved, and what were the consequences?
Yeah, you could start by saying, I mean, you can do the same reasoning you did for Calciopoli. I mean, there's always there must be someone who takes who profits from this, and in this case it was, I know it may sound weird, but it was about I'd say a betting cartel that was based in Singapore. So let's say in Singapore they have very not very strict betting regulations, and you can literally bet on anything which is happening. I mean, you can even bet on who will be the first guy who will throw, I don't know, a corner, for example, from a specific team. What happened is that these people from Singapore used some people in the Balkans as a proxy and got in touch with footballers and managers here in Italy to take advantage of the often not so healthy environment for what, as for sports. What happened is that some players, some teams try to take advantage of, let's say, of this opportunity, let's call it opportunity. I mean, they try to adjust some matches, try to take advantage of specific situations. We have to maybe, we should point out that most of the betting scandal in 2011 and 2012 was about lower league teams. It was not really about. It's not something that will shake the very foundation.
Which leagues was it? Was it Serie B or was it Pro Liga?
Was it Serie B? We had something in Lega Pro. We had very few consequences in Serie A as well. I can remember about Napoli, for example, but they just got a fine because you know when there is a footballer doing something on his own, you can't really blame the team. You know, it's you can't take the team in the wall. I mean, in the whole picture. So that's about it. But it, I mean, the 2011 and 2012 betting scandal was honestly even comical, because if you think about, there was a guy that was playing Cremonese, was a keeper. It was called Marco Paoloni. What he did, that he put sedatives in the water of his teammates just to. Make them, I don't know, collapse on the pitch and make them tired on the pitch and help the opposition to score. There are videos about Paoloni which are absolutely shocking. I mean, just I don't know, taking a penalty and there's Paoloni just pointing towards the bottom left corner running of his goal and saying, yeah, just shoot the ball there. There are other videos about him going outside the penalty area and allowing the striker to score. I mean, it was a point when where it was really comical. And I mean, even this that we had basically close to zero effect on a justice level, because that's how justice goes in Italy. In general, I mean, in sports, it's even worse because really the last scandal that was probably punished was the betting scandal during the 80s. That was something that very heavy for the time. But with Calciopoli, with Calcio Scommesse, it was really something. I don't know. It was very light. The sentences were really. I mean, sentences on a justice system should educate you to not do something like that in the future. Actually, what happened was the opposite. And for example, in the betting scandal, we have the example of Conte. I mean, Conte was in the eye of the hurricane because during his time at Bari and Siena was accused of. Knowing that, let's say, a match fixing was going on, and he didn't tell nothing about it. What happened is that Conte, I don't know, maybe people don't know about it, but he negotiated for a plea bargain. So he admitted his own guilty to the judge, and just to get away with it. So now, right now, we have the coach of our national team is someone who. Basically admitted to do something illegal on a sports level. Now I don't know if he did that to make a t-shirt, because we know how trials go in Italy. Just he decided to negotiate a plea and go and just deal with it instead of carry on the process. Maybe it's innocent, maybe it's not, but still I think this is a strong sign of what of what the sport justice is in Italy.
It sounds incredibly poor. I never realised that that Conti was involved, or allegedly involved, of course. I never really understood that. I couldn't believe that. That's absolutely outrageous, the amount of... And especially so soon after the big scandal beforehand about match fixing. It's absolutely ridiculous. But I don't know. I mean, the fact that you're... Well, to be fair, Conte's probably... You know, I probably prefer Conte in charge than Roy Hodgson for us, but... You know, yeah. I don't know. But it's very strange.
Yeah.
Gio, you touched on it a bit there. But overall, do you think the Italian justice system handled this appropriately? I mean, you mentioned that there was the betting scandal in the 80s as well. Before the World Cup that Italy won. Is that the one you're referring to?
Yeah.
In 1982, so do you think the Italian justice system has handled these two betting scandals well enough? Or is it a case where you can't really say... it was either good or bad how they handled it, but rather they got some sentences right, some sentences wrong, etc.
You see, if you go back to the 80s when we had the Totonero, which is basically match fixing, but just for the betting. I mean, if you look at the other punishments, I mean, you got Milan, they got relegated in Serie B. Lazio got really good in Serie B. Other smaller teams got a penalty of specific points to for the next league. And as I said before, you're right on your on being doubtful, because if you look how 2006 was handled, I mean, you had two very strong decisions. I'm talking about the life ban for Giraud and Moggi. But you could argue that those two guys were probably not really the whole of the whole of the problem. I mean, there was a lot of more behind them. I mean, there was basically used as scapegoats, if you think about it. You should reflect on the time they took to make a decision. I mean, if you look at 2006, of course there was the World Cup, there was a new championship coming up, but still they decided to sort all the things in 5 months and to give a final sentence just right after the summer, I mean, around October and December. Calcio Scommesse is the same. I mean, if it's I mean, this situation reminds me a lot of Spain. I mean, in Spain, they have a really loose regulation for what concern doping and similar things. I think it's the same in Italy, not just for the doping, but just for the criminal activity in football, because they just tend to do tabula rasa to get rid of it, give small punishments. I mean, seriously, if you look at the sentences we had during the Calcio Scommesse, it's almost ridiculous. I mean, there are people still playing. I mean, people that are under investigation that are still playing. I'm thinking about Stefano Mauri from Lazio. I mean, there's it was really in the high of the arrogance. It's still his for what he has done and the relationship he had with the with those people with the betting scandal. So no, I would say that we were talking with John earlier, and he said that something like that happened in America, they would have been, I don't know, wiped out. While in with Calciopoli, we just got rid of it in 4 months. We got Serie B for Juventus. That was what everything wanted in Italy, basically. But no, we really need to change our mindset to have a better sports environment. Because this, if you go this way, I mean, trying always giving lights. Punishments to people, what will happen is that they will keep doing the same things all over again, because they know there's not going to be no serious consequences. And that's basically, I think that's the reason why we had the Calcio's committed a betting scandal in 2011 and 2012. They've seen in Calciopoli that they got a, say, decent punishment, but that was something very serious. I mean, that was, Calciopoli was something that required Calcio to be reformed at any level, political, financial, sport, etc. But yeah, I mean, this didn't stop the managers and footballers to try that for the second time, to make some profit out of it. So yeah, we need a really stronger justice department here in the sports sector. That's no doubt about it.
Okay, well, we've covered both of the most recent scandals over the decade. It's been very enlightening for me. I actually understand it a lot more, and I didn't realize how deep it went, especially with the punishments. Of course, Juventus are still feeling this today, whether rightly or wrongly, isn't for an InfoPod to discuss, but we will be talking about Milan-Roma, which seems like a lifetime ago, a lifetime of disappointment ago, for our next podcast, which will be next week. This, of course, has been our first Info podcast, so we're hoping to do many more. I think the next one we're going to cover is co-ownerships, because I don't particularly understand that. I've only learned what I know through Football Manager. So hopefully we've got Gio and Danny to describe it properly. Of course, they are ending, but there seems to be some sort of loopholes that we can talk about. If you have any suggestions, please remember to tweet us in. And that's it from us today. Thank you very much. Thank you, Gio, and for Danny for joining me as well.
Thank you, James. See you soon.
Cheers. Thanks, James. Cheers.
Parte Miralem, eccolo il tentativo di tiro, la palla respinta, il capitano tira, gol! Il gol del bimbo d'oro, una sassata del capitano, mamma mia, una sassata del capitano, questa volta nulla ha potuto Buffon, nono gol in campionato, 224 gol, Nordal ad un passo, il capitano, braccia al cielo, tutti i giocatori su di lui, tutto il pubblico è impazzito. Una sassata incredibile dal limite dell'area di rigore, imparabile per Buffon.